Well, let's continue now with what we talked about last night about the dangers of the evolution theory. We began answering the question, why is evolution a dangerous theory? We talked about the fact that it's bad science based on lies. Kids do not learn how to think when all they're taught is this evolution theory. It's like me asking somebody to explain how computers came to be, but you cannot use man as your answer. You have to give a naturalistic explanation. Well, you've already shut out the only logical answer. And the kids are in school are trying to learn how the universe came to be, but it can't be God, it's got to be something else. Well, you already shut out the only logical answer. So they're not learning how to think. It's a dangerous theory for science. It's a hindrance to the advancement of science, and it brings forth bad fruit. The Bible says an evil tree, every good tree which bringeth forth good fruit, but a corrupt tree bringeth forth evil fruit. A good tree cannot bring forth evil fruit, neither can a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. Evolution is the foundation philosophy for humanism, the idea that man is God of the universe. The humanist philosophy is talked about in Romans chapter 1. It says they did not like to retain God in their knowledge, so God gave them over to a reprobate mind to do those things which are not convenient. You ought to read all of Romans chapter 1 and see the steady slide people go down once they reject God as the creator. This fellow said, do humanists believe in a supreme being? Emphatically, yes. That supreme being is man. Humanists have no knowledge of any being more supreme. Well, I would be glad to introduce them to one if they'd lie. I know one.
Amen.
It's a whole lot more supreme. I mean, can you imagine if the infinite God could fit in your little 3-pound brain? It wouldn't be very big, and he sure wouldn't be worth worshiping. Man, the God that I worship is beyond comprehension.
Amen.
I mean, he tells us a lot about himself, but your brain just can't handle it. Neither can mine. So, this guy said, the turning point in history will be the moment that man becomes aware that the only God of man is man himself. Some of these guys think they are God. Boy, that was Hitler's philosophy. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. I'm God. Hey, Gabriel, come and listen to this. Ha, ha, ha. We're not such big stuff, folks. George Wald, the Nobel Prize winner, said, I will not accept that, talking about creation, philosophically, because I do not want to believe in God. Therefore, I choose to believe in that which, I know is scientifically impossible, spontaneous generation arising to evolution. He said, I know it's not possible, but the only other alternative is God did it, and I don't want that, so I'll believe the impossible. Well, you're going to feel awful stupid for eternity. No one, you missed the opportunity to live forever with the creator of the universe because you were willingly ignorant, just like 2 Peter says. This guy says, we no longer feel ourselves to be guests in someone else's home. He's talking about God. This is Rifkin, who's one of those tree huggers who writes all kinds of books about, you know, save the environment, kill all the people, but save the environment. Jeremy Rifkin said, we no longer feel ourselves to be guests in somebody else's home and therefore obliged to make our behavior conform to a set of pre-existing cosmic rules. It's our creation now. We make the rules. We establish the parameters of reality. We create the world, and because we do, we no longer feel beholden to outside forces. Talking about God, of course. He said, we no longer have to justify our behavior, for we are now the architects of the universe. We are responsible to nothing outside of ourselves. So we are the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Wow, he's right. The Bible said in 2 Peter, in the last days, scoffers would come that would be willingly ignorant of how God made the heavens and the earth was standing into the water and out of the water. We cover all that on video number 2. The Bible says the scoffers are going to be walking after their own lust. You know, the only reason people reject God is because of their lust. There's no scientific reason to reject the Bible. There's no scientific reason to reject the creation account. There's no scientific reason to reject the idea that there's a creator. But some people just don't like the idea of God telling them what to do. The idea of God chaps their hide. Well, I tell them they better get some Vaseline, man. They're going to need it because we're going to be judged by the very God you don't believe in. This guy says, we take the side of science in spite of the patent absurdity of some of its constructs, in spite of its failure to fulfill many of its extravagant promises of health and life, in spite of the tolerance of the scientific community for unsubstantiated just-so stories, because we have a prior commitment, a commitment to materialism. He said, materialism is an absolute. We cannot allow a divine foot in the door. A professor that I had in Illinois Central College in East Peoria, Illinois, wrote a really cool article years ago It was two computers arguing with each other, does man exist? Showing the absurdity of two humans trying to argue, does God exist? The computers couldn't see man, so therefore he didn't exist. And they were going through all kinds of explanations of how, you know, they gradually got all this circuitry by blind chance. The same kind of dumb arguments the evolutionists do, trying to explain how life arose by chance. What happened? Satan put it into the heart of some of his followers that they should build a kingdom and rule the world. And they really have serious plans to build a world empire right here. And you and I do not fit in. Matter of fact, they're anxious to get rid of us, big time, okay? Secretly, Satan plans to use his followers to destroy much of humanity. But then he's going to destroy them also. The communists have done that for years. They always get some revolutionaries to go in and take over a country. And the first thing the communists do when they take over, they kill the revolutionaries that killed everybody else because they can't trust them. And Satan is using some of his followers, and they've got it in their head that they need to reduce the population of the planet. We cover all that on videotape number one or in our college course, CSE 101. We cover that in great detail, how that there are people who think we should reduce man's population here to 1.5 billion. You can go to Elberton, Georgia, and see the Georgia Guidestones where it says right on there, maintain humanity under 0.5 billion. Right now there are 6 billion. They want to reduce the population by about 95%, according to Ted Turner. I said, well, go ahead, Ted, you first. They just get off anytime you want. Now, if evolution is true, then who owns the world? Who makes the rules? How do we determine right from wrong? I've asked people all over the place, how do you tell right from wrong if evolution is true? There simply is no possible way to tell right from wrong. It's a real simple question, but they have no answer. You can't tell right from wrong if evolution is true. If man is God, and this is what evolution means, then man makes the rules and the strongest survive. Might makes right. There's no way to tell right from wrong. I had a professor tell me one time, there are no absolutes. I said, are you absolutely sure? Blew his little brain. Now let me think for just a minute. How can I be absolutely? Yeah, of course they're absolutes. Kids today are wandering around in this world with no moral anchor because they don't know right from wrong. They really don't. There simply is no way to tell. Now, folks, there's a war going on, and you're going to have to decide which side you want to get on. You can't be neutral in this one. During the Civil War, this one fellow decided he did not want to get involved. By the way, it's not the Civil War, it's Abe Lincoln's War. Another long story. We cover that on CSE 103, okay, the college class number 103. During the Civil War, though, this guy decided he didn't want to get involved. So he put on a Yankee jacket and rebel pants. Said, both sides will leave me alone now. Well, after the battle, he was found dead, his Yankee jacket full of rebel bullet holes and his rebel pants full of Yankee bullet holes. Folks, there's a war going on. You might as well get on one side or the other. Just give it all you got. Give it to your general, okay? You just say, Lord, here I am reporting for duty. What would you like me to do? Amen. Here's the problem, as I understand it. There's a war going on between Satan and God. We are the battlefield. People are going to get hurt. People are going to get killed. You better just get on one side or the other. The decision is very simple. You just decide which side you want to be on and then do whatever your general says. If you want to serve the devil, you just go ahead. If you want to serve God, come on. It's wonderful. Henry Morris has a tremendous book on this topic, The Long War Against God. If you want to understand the history of the evolutionary conflict, this one is awesome. There's another one, I don't know if it's a close second or maybe a tie with this one, called In the Minds of Men by Ian Taylor. One of the best books I've ever read covering the whole history of this. Why do people think this way? And I encourage people to read good books. Now kids, you're going to be the same person you are 20 years from now as you are right now, except for the books you read and the people you meet. Shut off the TV once in a while and read some books. There are many good books that will influence you forever. Man, I've read books that just changed my life, brother. You come across some, it's like, wow, you're just a different person from then on. Now, the Christians have an incredible advantage in this war. I read the last chapter. We win.
Amen.
Now, between now and then, it's going to get pretty bad. We're going to cover some things tonight about the New World Order. It might be a little scary. Folks, you don't need to get nervous. I read lots of books about the New World Order. I think I have a fairly good grasp of what's going on. I read about the microchip and all kinds of things happening, you know, and I see the world events, and then I go to sleep. Because Psalm 2 is a great tranquilizer for that. We cover a whole lot more on the New World Order on our CSE class 103 for four different college courses that we offer. You can call our website for that. We're going to trace a little bit of the history of the conflict and then tell you what you can do about it. Things, practical things you can do for your general. God created the world. He owns it, and He makes the rules. The Bible says the earth is the Lord's. If you don't like it, then go make your own world. But He owns this place. About 6,000 years ago, probably within a first few hundred years after the creation, Lucifer decided he wanted to be God. There's no possible way Lucifer fell from heaven before the creation. We cover all that on videotape number 2 about the gap theory and the day-age theory. Satan could not have fallen before the creation. So sometime after the creation, maybe 100 years, Lucifer decided he wanted to be God. So God created the world. Satan rebelled against God and tried to destroy His creation. That's the subject of this session. First of all, it appears that Satan wants to do at least 3 things. He wants to make mankind wicked, so God will have to destroy them. Satan made everybody wicked in the days of Noah, and God had to kill them all but Noah and his family. So Satan works very hard to make people wicked just so that God will have to destroy His creation. That's one of Satan's goals. Number 2, he wants to convince some men to destroy other men. You guys like Adolf Hitler thinking they ought to kill the Jews, and guys like Pol Pot thinking they ought to kill the Cambodians. I mean, people think they ought to kill everybody. You got guys in the Taliban think they ought to kill anybody that won't convert to Islam. And by the way, the Quran clearly teaches if a person will not convert to Islam, they should be executed. We cover all that on video number 7. Now, praise God for the people that are trying to reach the Muslims, and they need the gospel like everybody else. But they're in the middle, they're absolutely brainwashed with the silly idea that if they're a good, faithful member of the Islam, they get to go to heaven and get 72 wives. They never thought about the 72 mother-in-laws. Or having to feed them 72 wives. Talk about it. We could get off on a long rabbit trail. We're going to do a whole videotape someday just on the dangers of Islam and that teaching. Now, the people can be saved and make great Christians. And God loves them, but He hates what they believe. They've been duped. You ought to get the book that we sell in our bookstore called The Prophet. If you want to understand the history of the Muslim church and how it got started, it'll scare you when you realize who started it and why. Get into that some other time. Number 3, Satan wants to keep as many people from hearing the gospel as possible. And that's where the evolution theory comes into the textbooks. The kids have an alternative explanation for how the world got here, so they never even consider looking for the real creator of the universe. Satan's used many different people and methods to accomplish his goals. He makes men think he is God, makes man think he is God, and makes the rule. Satan knew this would lead to genocide. Once people think they're in charge, well, then they decide they're going to rearrange the world the way they want it. So we're going to kill those that we don't want to be here. Ezekiel 28 tells about Lucifer. It says, "Thou wast perfect in the day that thou wast created, till iniquity was found in thee. The heart was lifted up because of thy beauty. Thou hast corrupted thy wisdom by reason of thy brightness. God said, I will cast thee to the ground. I will lay thee before kings, that they may behold thee. How art thou fallen from heaven, O Lucifer, son of the morning? How art thou cut down to the ground, which didst weaken the nations?" You know, this battle is really Satan versus God. It's not, you know, us versus them or cowboys versus Indians. It's Satan versus God. It's what it really boils down to. Isaiah tells us that Satan said, "I will ascend into heaven. I will exalt my throne above the stars. I will sit upon the mount of the congregation in the sides of the north. I will ascend above the heights of the clouds. I will be like the Most High. Yet thou shalt be brought down to hell, to the sides of the pit. They that see thee shall narrowly look upon thee and consider thee, saying, Is this the man that made the earth to shake, the earth to tremble, and did shake the kingdoms, that made the world as a wilderness and destroyed the cities?" You know, Judgment Day, we're going to stand before God, and we're going to see Satan getting ready to cast into hell. We're going to say, this is it? That's it? How many saw the movie Wizard of Oz? Remember when they finally realized it's a little old man behind the curtain pulling those levers? That's it? That's Oz? That's the way we're going to feel when we see Satan. You got to be kidding. That's it? When I went to Massachusetts, first time to speak at a church up there, I went to see Plymouth Rock. You know, where the pilgrims landed, you know, and we walked up to this little pavilion and the preacher said, "Well, go ahead and say it." I said, "Say what?" He said, "Say what everybody says when they see Plymouth Rock." I said, "That's it?" He said, "Yep, that's it. That's what everybody says." It's a rock about this big with a date on there, 1620, you know. That's it, yeah. We're going to look at Satan and say, "That's the one that made the nations tremble? You got to be kidding." And the people who are going to go to hell for eternity are going to feel awfully dumb realizing they got deceived by such a simple process. They were so blinded. How many of you have ever been fooled and you felt just real stupid afterwards? You ever do that? Like, duh, how could I be fooled by that? That's the way folks that go to hell are going to feel. Like, wow, you got to be kidding. Satan is making his plans to rule the world, like Pinky in the Brain. God's up in heaven laughing about it. Now look, when you get all nervous about the new world order, just read Psalms chapter 2. It's a great tranquilizer. Psalm 2 said, "Why do the heathen rage and the people imagine a vain thing? The kings of the earth set themselves, the rulers take counsel together against the Lord, against his anointed, saying, let us break their bands asunder and cast away their cords from us. He that sitteth in the heavens shall laugh." You know, they've got plans for a new world order. They really do. They have plans for an electronic currency where you can't buy anything without a chip in your hand or in your forehead. Plans are coming soon. There are plans to control the planet. They want to control the food. They want to control the population. They want you to get a permit to cut your grass and cut down a tree on your property. They got plans to rule the world, folks, and it's serious. God's laughing about the whole thing. They're planning to build their kingdom. You ought to read the book of Daniel and see how this kingdom, how that God tells the whole history right there. Nebuchadnezzar was the head of gold, you know, the nearly pure kingdom, absolute authority, then the silver chest and arms, and then the belly and thighs of brass, and the legs of iron, the Roman Empire. You can read through all the book of Daniel and see the five kingdoms. Well, the last kingdom is where 10 kingdoms try to get together, but it's partly iron, partly clay. It's going to be weak and it's going to crumble. And in those days, the Lord's going to cut a stone out of the mountain without hands, and it's going to smite the image on the feet. God's going to set up his kingdom. We'll talk more about that in a minute. It started by Satan tricking Eve in the Garden of Eden. He said to the woman, "Yea, hath God said?" The first thing Satan always does is question God's word. Then he said, "Ye shall not surely die." That's an outright denial of God's word. And then he said, "Eve, if you eat off of that tree, ye shall be as gods." That's the same technique he's always used. Make you doubt God's word, then he denies God's word, and then he says, "See, you're going to be God." Wow, I get to be God. That's what humanism is all about. Satan's plan's always been the same. Make you doubt, deny God's word, and then deify mankind. Tell you, you can evolve. He tried the same thing with Jesus. He said, "Jesus, if you fall down and worship me, all these things will I give you." Isn't that what he told him? "I'll give you all this stuff if you just worship me." He's a liar. He doesn't own it to begin with. And Satan always promises people things if you'll follow me. He said, "All these things will I give thee if thou wilt fall down and worship me." Jesus answered and said, "It is written." That's all you got to do, folks. When the devil starts giving you a hard time, just start quoting scripture to him. He can't stand that. But he knows the scripture really well. He'll take half a verse here and there. See what he did all through scripture. Okay? He'll take half a verse. Just got to watch what he's doing. So a satanic high priest, Aleister Crowley, said that his demon told him the year 2000 would mark the end of the superstition of Christianity and the beginning of the golden age, when those possessing the will to dominate would conquer and would ascend to godhood. Well, guess what, Mr. Crowley? You missed it. And you're not going to ascend to godhood. You're going to descend to worm food.
That's right.
So what's going to happen. Satan wants you to think you can evolve into a god. Now, what you believe determines how you behave. That's always been the case throughout the world. The Bible says, "Beware lest any man spoil you through philosophy and vain deceit, after the tradition of men and the rudiments of the world, and not after Christ." Philosophy means the love of man's wisdom. Sophie means man's wisdom, where we get a word sophomore. Soph means wise. More, where we get our word moron, means fool. A sophomore is a wise fool. That's the age where they usually think they know it all. How many been there before? You've seen those kind? Okay, yeah, sophomore. They picked the word very carefully for that age group. Soph means wise. Man's wisdom, philosophy, philio, the love of. Maybe been to Philadelphia, the city of brotherly shove, or whatever they call it, okay? Evolution is nothing but a philosophy. It's not a science, it's a philosophy, it's a religion. What it does, it tries to make you think that we can take God out and put man in his place. There are some excellent books you ought to be reading if you want to get up on all the philosophy of man's wisdom. You can read Seven Men Who Rule from the Grave. Oh, the philosophy of these seven guys who absolutely still govern the world today. People like Karl Marx, Joseph Stalin, guys like that. You can read about the Fourth Reich of the Rich, how that some of the rich people in the world, I mean the super rich people, have plans to control the world. Big time serious plans. You want to get more on the Council of Foreign Relations and how they are involved. These are all books we sell in our bookstore. I have people that get after me, brother. There's a couple of other, I think, good friends of mine that they say, "Oh, you get off on too many rabbit trails. It doesn't tie into creation." Oh, I think freedom ties directly into creation. Yeah. Our founding father said, "We hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are..." created equal. They're endowed by their creator. So to me, the creation movement ties directly into things like gun control, stuff like that. I don't have a problem with it at all. You know, coming from some country where they don't have our American roots, I can understand where they don't see how it fits in, but sorry, it does fit in. Dr. Henry Moore says this great book about the long war against God. Now, evolution is the foundation philosophy for racism. How can you think one person is superior to somebody else? Some people thought, well, if there is no God and we just evolved from apes, which are dark colored, maybe the white-skinned people have evolved farther. By the way, racism's been around a long time, but boy, when Darwin's book came out, it's like throwing gas on a fire. Racism escalated incredibly after that. Evolution is the foundation philosophy for racism. Charles Darwin wrote a book. Here it is right here. It's called The Origin of Species. That's not the whole title to the book. They're kind of embarrassed by the whole title because it is very politically incorrect. I'll show it to you in a second. This book says The Origin of Species. Now, this book came out 1859. The evolution theory was around way before that. But Darwin simply made it popular. He gave them an excuse of how it happened. Now, what is a species anyway? This textbook shows a bunch of different monkeys and says they're all different species. Okay, but they're the same kind of animal. They're still a monkey. And just because some guy decides that we've got, you know, 12 species of monkeys here, doesn't mean they're different kinds. They're still the same kind of animal. This textbook, used in Escambia for a while, shows the different, a little more to the title. It says, Darwin's published his findings in a book titled, On the Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection. That's still not the whole title. Here's the whole title to the book. You can look at it yourself. The Origin of Species by Means of Natural Selection, or The Preservation of Favored Races in the Struggle for Life. Oh, favored races. Now, Charlie, that's not politically correct. Well, back in 1859 it was. 1859, we had slavery in this country, folks. Racism was very popular, even in the non-slave states. They didn't want them to be enslaved, but they still thought they were inferior in many cases. Darwin thought natives were just advanced animals. Darwin said in the book Descent of Man, another book he wrote, he said, at some future period, not very distant as measured by centuries, the civilized races of man will almost certainly exterminate and replace the savage races throughout the world. Now, if a professor said that today, how long would he keep his job? By the way, you ought to go read the old newspapers. I mean, like 100 years ago, and see how they talked about the Indians as being savages. They always referred to them as savages, like they're inferior somehow. Darwin said in his book, thus from the war of nature, from famine and death, the most exalted object we are capable of conceiving, the production of higher animals, directly follows. See, Darwin's philosophy was messed up. He thought the more war, the more famine, the more death you have, the faster things evolve. The question is really very simple. Did man bring death into the world? Or did death bring man into the world? Could not be more opposite. Darwin's philosophy says death brought man into the world. Now, you have to understand, in 1859, when this book came out, slavery was legal in many parts of the world. By the way, there's still slavery going on today in many parts of the world. Okay? Negroes were bought and sold like cows. You owned them like property. You could do with them as you please. They had absolutely no rights. Now, Henry Fairfield Osborne, who was the curator at the American Museum of Natural History, said, the standard of intelligence of the average adult Negro is similar to that of the 11-year-old youth of the species Homo sapien. He's trying to get across the idea that Negroes are a different species, isn't he? That's racism. Stephen Gould admitted, biological arguments for racism may have been common before 1850, but they increased by orders of magnitude following the acceptance of evolution theory. Thomas Huxley was the guy who promoted Darwin all over the country. Darwin wrote his book and went and hid. Huxley went out and really preached Darwin and made people accept what he said. Huxley said, no rational man, cognizant of the facts, believes that the average Negro is the equal, still less the superior of the white man. These are the guys who promoted Darwin. A guy named Kingsley, who was an Anglican priest who really promoted Darwin, also, you know, if it hadn't been for the church accepting Darwin in the 1850s and 60s, the scientists rejected it at first. They said, what a dumb theory. It was the Christians that accepted it. Kingsley said, The black people of Australia, exactly the same race as the African Negro, cannot take in the gospel. They can't get saved. He said, all attempts to bring them to a knowledge of the true God have as yet failed utterly. Poor brutes in human shape, they must perish off the face of the earth. They're inferior species. Brother, I was working in Longview, Texas at a church there. I was out 2 in the morning going to the store to get my wife some milk or something. I forget what it was, and I get one of the babies something at that time. And some guy had gotten drunk, and he turned his car down what he thought was a street, but it was a railroad track. He drove about, 30 feet, and the car bottomed out, and he's stuck on the tracks, And he's standing out there looking at his car. What happened here, He's drunk. And so I stopped to go see what I could do to help, and another guy stopped, and we're pushing this car back off the railroad tracks before a car comes along and turns it into a tin can, And this guy said, what are you doing out here in the middle of the night? It was an all-black neighborhood right by the big ghetto housing project there. I said, I came by here to see if any of my friends are up, because I know a bunch of people here in the housing project in the ghetto here, and I bring a lot of these folks to church. He said, you bring them to church? I said, yeah, I drive a bus, come in here every Sunday, bring a lot of them to church. He said, these people are all black. I said, yeah, so what? He said, well, why do you bring them to church? I said, well, I try to get them saved and, help them learn the Bible and go just like Jesus told me to do. He said, what do you mean get them saved? They don't have souls. I said, are you part of the KKK? He said, yeah, how'd you know? Oh, just a lucky guess, Well, listen, you idiot, they do have souls as much as you do. The color of your skin makes no difference. In part 7, we talk about where the races come from. There aren't any races. There's one race called the human race. Now, there are different skin colors. I can show you different skin colors of cows, too. Black cows, brown cows, and white cows. But they all look the same in the meat locker. And they all taste the same on the hamburger, okay? And all humans are the same, regardless of the color of their skin. Here's the Mormon Church's teaching, though, about Negroes. The Mormon Church teaches Negroes in this life are denied the priesthood. Negroes are not equal with other races. It's the Lord's doing. It's based on His eternal laws of justice and grows out of a lack of spiritual valiance of those concerned in their first estate. When I was living over on Burgess Road, I had 2 Mormon missionaries come knock on my door. They said, Mr. Hovind, we'd like to talk to you about the Lord. I said, that'd be great. Which Lord would you like to talk about, yours or mine? He said, oh, we worship the same God. I said, no, we don't. I said, tell me, fellas, does your God have a body like mine? They said, oh, yeah. I said, well, my Bible says God's a spirit, and they that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. See, if He has a body, He can only be in one place at a time. But if He's a spirit, He can be in all places at all times, simultaneously. I said, does your God live on the planet Kolob, K-O-L-O-B? They said, yeah, we believe He does. I said, does your God have thousands of wives? They said, yeah, we believe He does. I said, does your God have normal physical relations with those wives and beget spirit babies in heaven? They said, yeah, we believe He does. I said, now, do you guys believe that if the spirit baby is a valiant spirit baby, if it's a good spirit baby in heaven, when it comes to earth, it gets a white-skinned body? But if it's a bad spirit baby, it gets a black-skinned body. Is that what you believe? They said, well, you're not supposed to know that, but yeah, that is what we believe. By the way, that is what they believe. I said, now, fellas, let me see if I understand this. Now, your God in heaven supplies a spirit baby for every human baby born on earth. Is that right? They said, that's right. I said, okay, fellas, now listen. I know you have the little tag that says elder, even though you're 17. But I said, fellas, I've been married 30 years now. I got 3 kids. I've got grandkids. I taught biology and anatomy. I used to raise hamsters. I said, did you know there are 2 babies born every second? 2 per second, 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. I said, and your God supplies a spirit for everyone. When does He get time to answer your prayers? Boy, they knocked the dust off their feet, and I guess I was anathema from then on, because they never came back, brother. I don't know. I wanted to talk to them some more, but they didn't want to talk to me no more. That's a dumb idea that you could black spirit babies up in spirit babies in heaven. This is dumb. This is crazy. Okay? It's not true. We're all equal. This Mormon apostle said, in a broad sense, caste systems have their root and origin in the gospel. It's by divine decree. He said, Cain, Ham, and the whole Negro race have been cursed with black skin, the mark of Cain. That is just silly, okay? This Mormon apostle said, if there's one drop of Negro blood in my children, as I've read to you, they receive the curse. The curse of black skin. That's dumb. He said, "Shall I tell you the law of God in regard to the African race? If the white man who belongs to the chosen seed mixes his blood with the seed of Cain, the penalty under the law of God is death on the spot. This will always be so." By the way, you ought to read the book, The Secret History of the Mormon Church. Get the phone number there. Go to the website, UTLM, UtahLighthouseMission.org, if you want to get all the lowdown on how the Mormons have killed people for trying to leave the Mormon Church or for marrying someone who's not the right color. Now, I know I'm in the South, and I preach the same message all over the South, but if you think you're superior because of the color of your skin, you're wrong, you're stupid, and you're not right with God.
Amen.
Okay, I have brought thousands of black people to the Lord, and I intend to keep doing it, okay? And they're going to be in heaven whether you like it or not. But during the slave trade time in America here, the slaves were packed onto ships and brought over like cows. I mean, it was common for 20% of them to die. They would bring them on the ship and chain them to the deck, and that's where they stayed for 2 or 3 weeks. I mean, they ate, slept, and went to the bathroom, same place, for 2 or 3 weeks. They didn't get up. Brought them over. Miserable, miserable conditions they brought them into, and then sold them over here like cows. Now, praise God for the good people who tried to take care of them. You know, some people really were good to their slaves. But the whole concept of slavery is based on the idea that one person is superior because of the color of his skin or because of what he believes. This is based, goes right back to the evolution teaching. Now, some people thought the Aborigines from Australia were inferior because they have bigger jaw bones, which is true. Their jaws are bigger. If you study the jaw of an Aboriginal, the bone structure is heavier. And people say, see, that's proof of evolution. No, it's not. The Aborigines are a nomadic society. They don't want to carry a toolbox around, so they carry the minimum with them, and when they get to where they got to go, they have to make their own tools again. And they use their teeth as a vice. They're constantly using their jaws as well as their hands, anything they've got, okay? And any bodybuilder will tell you, the more you build your muscles, the bigger the bones grow. So a person who's always using his jaws, his masseter muscles, is going to end up with bigger bones in response to that. After a lifetime of using your teeth like they do, you're going to have big jaw bones. It's got nothing to do with evolution. But somebody noticed this back 150 years ago and said, wow, the Aborigines have bigger jaw bones. So they went over and began robbing the graves of the Aborigines to get their heads for museums to be demonstrations for evolution. They treated the Aborigines awful. If you've seen the movie Quigley Down Under, where he brought people over there just to shoot the Aborigines, that kind of stuff really happened. They thought they were just, you know, an animal. These two folks went to Australia to collect specimens for museums. Interesting story here in Creation Magazine. They said right here, a New South Wales missionary was the horrified witness to the slaughter by mounted police of a group of dozens of Aboriginal men, women, and children. 45 heads were then boiled down and the best 10 skulls packed off for overseas. They shot them just to get their heads for museum displays. Now, why would a museum want a head with a bigger jawbone? As part of an evolution display. Did you know the Smithsonian, I've been told, has 33,000 sets of human remains in their basement right now? They call it the Army of the Potomac. They would find people with the right jaw structures and put them on display in their museum. See, boys and girls, how this ape evolved to the human? When the intermediates, there's another human. You can go downtown Pensacola and line up 10 people and prove the same thing, folks. We could line up folks in this room. Some of you have bigger jaws and smaller jaws and sloped forehead and straight forehead. I had an Italian friend one time. I said, man, I got to look at you from the side. I could put you in a textbook, you know? His head went back like that. His nose stuck out. I said, you're the perfect missing link. Guy had an IQ way up there in the stratosphere. Brilliant guy. Just had a dumb-looking head, you know? And by the way, the size of the head has got nothing, the brain has nothing to do with intelligence either. There have been some incredibly high IQ people with brain sizes down around 1,200 cc. And there have been some really dumb people with some really big heads with 2,000 cc brains, okay? It's got nothing to do with intelligence. America, though, during this late 1800s, because of the evolution theory primarily, had a large eugenics movement. Eugenics was the idea that we need to purify the race, get rid of the inferior genes, and only let the superior genes produce children. There was actually a sterilization movement. People who were mentally deficient were often sterilized. They couldn't have any children. There was a large eugenics movement until World War II broke out. Galton was Darwin's cousin, and Francis Galton, very influential in the eugenics movement. He said, "Is the study of the agencies under social control, it is the study, eugenics is the study of the agencies under social control to that improve or impair the racial qualities of future generations, either physically or mentally." That's Darwin's cousin. Now let's improve the race. Here's their logo and their motto, the tree of eugenics. Eugenics is the self-direction of human evolution. They're going to use medicine, surgery, psychiatry, sociology, religion, education, genealogy. They use it all. Like a tree, eugenics draws its materials from many sources and organizes them into a harmonious entity. They were going to work really hard to improve humanity by eliminating inferior genes. This is a person very involved in this was the one who started Planned Parenthood. We cover more on that on video number 4. In 1904, the World's Fair was held in St. Louis, Missouri. One of the displays on there was a huge display of many people involved in showing the evolution theory. Right here's a picture. At the 1904 World's Fair, 2,000 primitive peoples were put on display. The purpose of the display was to demonstrate the superiority of the white Americans who had evolved further. Peter Jennings, liberal Peter Jennings, wrote a book and mentioned this in there. And if you go to the St. Louis Zoo today, that is on the place where the World's Fair was held, and they're still using some of those same buildings. There in St. Louis at the 1904 World's Fair, they had a man in a cage with chimpanzees to demonstrate the evolution theory. The man was a pygmy from Australia, or a pygmy from Africa, a little bitty pygmy, about 4'5", I think he was. Ota Benga was his name. Ota had a wife and 2 kids. They put him in a cage with chimpanzees. He went insane and killed himself. Why would they do that to somebody? Well, if you believe in evolution, man's just an animal. Even President Roosevelt, as good a man as he was in many ways, was caught up into this false thinking. Roosevelt thought that the Indians were an inferior species. Roosevelt said, "I wish very much the wrong people could be prevented entirely from breeding." Roosevelt thought the immigrants from Europe, Scotland, Ireland, and the Orient were a threat to American society. How many of you have ancestors from one of those places? Just about everybody in the room? Yep, you're a threat to American society because you have inferior genes. That's what he thought. In 1871, Congress scrapped all treaties with the Indians and moved them off to the reservation system still in use today. They made promises to the Indians and broke them. After all, they're only savages, they're inferior. The Trail of Tears took place before Darwin's book came out, but still, evolution was very much taught before Darwin's book. Darwin just simply made it popular. But in the Trail of Tears, the Cherokee Indians were moved off their land by force to Oklahoma. About a third of them died along the way. Sam Houston married a Cherokee bride. He was really upset about what's going on with the white people picking on these Indians for no reason other than they thought they were an inferior species, which goes right back to the evolution teaching. When they took the Indians out of Ross's Landing, Tennessee, they moved the Indians out 2 weeks before harvest time. They did all the work, planted the crops, tended them all summer long, just before harvest time, came in with soldiers and guns, loaded them into wagons, and moved them out. And of course, the white people moved into their houses already made, you know, crops ready to harvest. Man, pretty nice. So people would forget about what happened, this horrible slaughter of the Indians. They renamed the city. It used to be called Ross's Landing after Chief Ross. Now they call it Chattanooga. Renamed to honor or to make people forget what happened. Here's an article from Franklin College in Franklin, Indiana. The Carnegie Institute of Washington, Eugenics Record Office, founded by Mrs. E.H. Harriman. Anybody heard that name before? E.H. Harriman. How many saw Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid? He's getting ready to blow up the train, you know, and he said, "I work for Mr. E.H. Harriman." Super rich gazillionaire back in those days, very much involved in wanting to improve humanity by eliminating the inferior. Carnegie started the organization, now in Berkeley, California, that fights to keep creation out of schools. It's his funding that supplied the start of that organization. The whole idea that man is superior, there's a bunch of guys been involved in this. The Bible says, "Have we not all one Father? You're not superior because of the color of your skin." The Bible says, "He hath made of one blood all nations of men to rule on the earth." Now, Darwin thought that a married man was a poor slave worse than a Negro. Regardless, we won't comment on whether it's true or not, but if it's not, by the way, but if a professor said that today, how long would he keep his job? Or his life? some of these feminazis to go kill him, wouldn't they? And yet they praised Darwin in our school system. Louisiana, I don't know if they got it passed or not, they were working on a bill to ban the teaching of Darwin because of his racism. Very interesting approach. Yeah. I mean, if our school started teaching the teachings of Adolf Hitler and made it mandatory reading, wouldn't people get upset? Well, why aren't they upset about the mandatory teaching of Darwinism? Darwin said, the chief distinction of intellectual powers between the two sexes is shown by man's attaining to a higher eminence in whatever he takes up. Whether requiring deep thought, reason, or imagination, or merely the use of the senses and hands, the average mental power in man must be above that of woman. Darwin finally married his first cousin, Emma Wedgwood. Nobody else would take him. Darwin thought men were superior in every single way. Darwin believed in inbreeding, so he married Emma, his first cousin. He wanted to raise a superior stock of children. He ended up having 10 children. Mary died shortly after birth. Anne died at 10. Robert was born retarded and died at 19 months. Henrietta had a serious nervous breakdown at 15. Three of his other six sons were ill so often, Charles regarded them as semi-invalids. So much for inbreeding, Charlie. Evolution is the foundation for communism. Communism, started by a guy named Karl Marx, removes God from authority and puts man in his place. He says, there is no God, so man must be in charge. Missionaries have said, when they're working in a country and the communists take over, the first thing the communists do when they come into the country, they go into the schools and they start teaching communism? No. They start teaching evolution. They start by laying a foundation of evolution, and then they bring in the teachings of communism. Communism can't thrive in a place where people believe they've got rights that come from the Creator. And the creation movement in America is one of the biggest hindrances to the advancement of the New World Order. And they very much would like to get rid of guys like me who don't believe in evolution. The guy who founded the ACLU, the American Communist Lawyers Union, or the Anti-Christian Lawyers Union, whatever it is, Roger Baldwin said, communism is the goal. You ought to read the history of the founding of the ACLU. One of the purposes of that lawyers movement was to advance the cause of communism. Karl Marx, whose name, a real name, was Moses Mordecai Marx Levy, alias Karl Marx, when he was 17 years old, he wrote a beautiful paper telling how much he loved the Lord. High school graduation, he had a paper saying, man, I want to serve God with my life. Then he went off to college. He studied philosophy, and a college professor turned him away from God and turned him on to the teaching of evolution and destroyed Marx's whole philosophy of life. Karl Marx was destroyed by this teaching. You know, 75% of kids from Christian homes that go off to secular schools lose their faith. I meet them by the hundreds all year long. Some college professor destroys their faith. Karl Marx later in life said, my objective in life is to dethrone God and destroy capitalism. Marx based his whole philosophy of communism on the idea of evolution. Karl Marx even tried to dedicate his book to Charles Darwin. From a sincere admirer, Karl Marx. Marx knew his theories would not survive without evolution as the foundation philosophy. They go together hand in glove. Karl Marx had six children. Three died of starvation in infancy. Two others committed suicide. When Marx died, only six people attended his funeral. But his philosophy is still ruling one-third of the planet today. You know, one-third of the people on planet Earth are under communism right now. Started by a loser who never worked a day in his life, let his own kids starve to death. He was a loser. Karl Marx developed what we call the Communist Manifesto in 1848. You want to take over a country? Here's how communism works. First thing you do is abolish private property. And by the way, this is the real purpose behind the environmental movement in America. They're not trying to save the environment. Some probably are. But the basic idea behind the movement is abolish private property. You got to get their permit to cut down your tree. That's where it's headed, folks. The Bible talks about private property ownership quite a bit. You know, every 50 years you got your property back. You could not lose it forever. Your family's going to get it back. If you're a loser, you're lazy or whatever, you don't pay your bills and they take it away, your family will get it back every 50th year. The Bible talks about having his own vine and his own fig tree. Drink water out of your own cistern. Running water's out of thine own well. You know, the solution to pollution in America is private property ownership. Ask anybody that's ever owned a house and rented it out to somebody else. They will understand. Renters don't look at property the same way owners do. How many know what I'm talking about? Okay, there you go. And the more property the government owns, the worse pollution's going to get. Peter Burrell, the president of the National Audubon Society, said, "We reject the idea of private property." Well, he's got a good communist philosophy along with Bill Clinton and Hillary. Here's a pledge of allegiance put up at a public school in Massachusetts. Look at this carefully. "I pledge allegiance to the earth, which I do love and depend on, and to all life and land, air and sea, which is as much a part of earth as me." At a third grade school in Wisconsin, here's the pledge the kids say. "I pledge allegiance to the world, to care for earth, sea, and air, to honor every living thing with peace and justice everywhere." 3 days ago, I was speaking in Minnesota, and I got to see this young man again who's now grown up. But he told me a couple of years ago, Jacob did, he said, "Brother Hovind, when I was in third grade at Johnsonville Elementary School in Blaine, Minnesota, his teacher, Ms. Klobhockey, took down the American flag and made the kids pledge to the earth instead." Well, Ms. Klobhockey, I will buy you a one-way ticket to the Soviet Union on the condition you use it and you don't come back. Call me anytime. Well, I'll buy you one. I've been to communist countries, folks. Trust me, you don't want what they've got. Now, America has lots of problems, I understand. But I love my country, folks. I fear my government, but I love my country. There are basically two philosophies of government. One is based on evolution thinking, which says laws come from man's opinion. How do you decide right from wrong? Oh, man gets together and we decide. Second thing, they say rights are granted by the government. And the government should be the provider. The government provides everything. This is called a democracy. Democracies always become dictatorships. They are horrible forms of government. The government should provide everything. When they were debating about health care here in Pensacola, I heard on the radio, you know, several years ago, talking about a national health care plan. I thought, did you know 70 to 80% of all health care costs are from self-induced problems? Somebody wants to drink or smoke or take drugs, and when they get sick, they want me to pay for it? They were debating on the radio here in one of the WCOA, I think it was, talking about should we have a national health care plan. So I called in. I said, I think it was Luke I got. I said, "Hey, Luke, I think we should have a, I got an idea here." I forget how I started off. I said, "I forgot to change oil in my car, and I blew the engine. I think everybody should help me pay for it." They said, "Well, if you forgot to change oil and you blew your engine, that's your problem." I said, "Well, this is exactly the same idea with health care. If you don't want to take care of your health, I guess that's your business. But if you get sick, why should I have to pay for it? If you don't want to brush your teeth and floss your teeth, you do whatever you want. They're your teeth, but I'm not going to pay you to get you new ones. I got to take care of my own too, you know. If we're going to have universal health care, why not universal auto care? If you ever damage your car, the government will pay for it." How's that for an idea? How about universal house care? You got a problem with your house, you need new doors, you need new carpet, hey, the government will pay for it. How about the government pay all utility bills? You don't have to yell at your kids anymore. Shut the refrigerator. Do you realize what would happen in a hurry? The whole system would crumble. That's what the Canadians are just now trying to figure out. Wow, how come it's costing us so much for this health care? I haven't had any health insurance now for 14 years. I take my vitamins. A lot of them. I probably spend 40, 50 bucks a month on vitamins and nutrition for me and my wife. Wow, that's a lot of money. Cheaper than $400 a month for health insurance, isn't it? And well, when you get sick, it's neat. You go to the hospital, they have to do something, you know, some kind of surgery. I remember one of my boys had surgery, and the hospital bill was like $4,500, you know, for 2 hours in an outpatient place. So I called the different people. I called the anesthesiologist. I said, "Hello, sir, I noticed your bill here is $1,500 for an hour and a half, you know, put him to sleep. I don't have any insurance. I do pay my bills, and I'll pay whatever I have to, but that seems kind of high for an hour and a half, you know." He said, "Oh, you don't have insurance? Okay, let's make it $300. Just like that over the phone. I called the place that had the room, you know. I'm sure they had to change the sheets and put some new Band-Aids out and stuff, you know. And I said, "Listen, I saw your bill here. It was like, you know, $1,800. That seems kind of high for an hour and a half, you know, for your room." I just said, "I don't have any insurance." He said, "Oh, you don't? Okay, let's make it $400. I got the bill down from, I think, $4,500 down to about $1,000, just over the phone with five phone calls. You don't have insurance? Oh, okay. The more people have insurance, the more it raises the price of everything. Now, I'm not against health insurance, okay, but I'm saying the philosophy here is what's important to understand. We got this crazy idea that the government's supposed to provide everything. Well, they'll be glad to do that, but along with that, they're going to take away all your freedoms. Our founding father said, we hold these truths to be self-evident. All men are created equal. For instance, who gives you the right to have a church? Then why do we ask the government for permission? You know, just about every church in America now has become 501c3 incorporated because they want to get a government handout. You ought to get the book Hush Money, or the bigger version of it, In Caesar's Grip, by Peter Kershaw, a good friend of mine. You want to find out all the dangers of 501c3 incorporation. The church doesn't have to get incorporated, but if you do get incorporated, you better not preach against certain things from your pulpit. You know, if you're an incorporated church and you preach against homosexuality, IRS will pull your tax-exempt status. Churches are tax-exempt anyway. What are we asking them that for? Come on. I'll read the book if you want more on that. Patrick Henry said, it cannot be emphasized too strongly that this great nation was founded by Christians, not on religions, but on the gospel of Jesus Christ. See, the other philosophy of government is based on creation thinking, which says laws come from the Creator, rights are unalienable, and the government should be limited to the punishment of evildoers and defense, the only two legitimate functions of government. They're not supposed to provide everything for you. You ought to read Davy Crockett's story about, he's out, you know, a house, a neighborhood burned in Washington, D.C. when Davy Crockett was senator or something like that. And the senators got together and said, you know, this whole neighborhood burned. What a horrible tragedy. Everybody lost their house here. Let's vote to give this neighborhood, you know, $50,000, whatever it was way back then, you know, to rebuild their homes. The next fall, Davy Crockett's out stumping, trying to get people to vote for him. And he saw this farmer plowing his field, and he stopped and said, hey, neighbor. Farmer stopped and said, yes, sir, can I help you? He said, I'm Davy Crockett. He said, yes, sir, I know who you are. He said, well, I want to see if you vote for me. The farmer said, no, sir, I'll never vote for you again in my life. He said, well, why not? He said, you broke your trust. He said, I voted for you last time to put you in there to manage things for our area, and you blew it. He said, well, how did I blow it? What did I do? He said, well, you voted to give those people money to rebuild their houses. Crockett said, well, yeah, that was a horrible thing that happened. You know, a big fire swept through the community or something. And the farmer said, are you going to do this for every tragedy across America? What if I lose my crop? What if my cow dies? This is a slippery slope, folks. There's no way out of this one. You have no business to give away our money. Now, if you congressmen want to get together and pool your money and give those folks some money, you go ahead. We've entrusted you to manage our money. We've got the whole story. It's amazing. If you call us or email us, we'll send that to you. Davy Crockett said, boy, he learned his lesson. But the senators and representatives today do not understand that lesson. They love giving away your money. Long story on that. A republic, though, is based on the idea that the law is supreme. Our government started off to be a constitutional republic, not a democracy. And I get real nervous when I hear them talk about spread democracy around the world. It'd be the dumbest thing we could do. Talk about a dumb form of government. The second part of Karl Marx's plan was a heavy progressive income tax. Don't get me started on that one, okay? The third thing he said was abolish the rights of inheritance. The Bible says a good man leaves inheritance to his children's children. Everything about communism is backwards to the biblical plan for things. Number four, confiscate property rights. Take away the property. The Bible says the love of money is the root of all evil. Karl Marx said we need a central bank. He knew full well a central bank could destroy the country. And in 1913, some rich guys got together on Jekyll Island, Georgia, and tricked everybody with the Federal Reserve. Nothing federal about it, and there are no reserves. The Federal Reserve is a private bunch of bankers. Remember, love of money is root of all evil. Got a whole lot more on that in our college class, CSE 103. Number six. Government ownership of communication. That's why we have an FCC, Federal Communication Commission. And government ownership of transportation. That's why we now have the TSA, the Transportation Security Administration. I go to the airports. I flew 175 times last year. I'll break that this year. I go to the airports and there'll be 50 people standing around, you know, to check everything. I went once and they took my fingernail clipper out, this big. It had a little thing that swings out to clean your fingernails. They said, oh, can't have that. It broke it off. You got to be kidding. I'm going to take over a plane with a fingernail clipper. They're paranoid. Number seven, Government ownership of factories and agriculture. Number 8, government control of labor. Number 9, corporate farms and regional planning. Number 10, free education. You know, the public school idea came from Karl Marx. Now, there were public schools before that, I understand, but Karl Marx said that government should do free education for everybody. Well, my PhD's in education. My mom taught for years and retired. My brother's in his 34th year now teaching public school. I speak in hundreds and hundreds of schools across the world. Folks, I'm for education, but I'm dead set against government involvement in education. Government's got no business being involved in education at all. You better read your Constitution, the 10th Amendment. Unless that's spelled out in that document, the government shouldn't do it. We've gotten a long ways away from that. Hitler said, "You let me control the textbooks, I'll control the state." Martin Luther said, "I am much afraid that the schools will prove to be the great gates to hell unless they diligently labor in explaining the scriptures, engraving them in the hearts of youth." He said, "I would advise no one to place his child where the scriptures do not reign paramount. Every institution in which men are not increasingly occupied with the Word of God must become corrupt." Well, go walk the halls of the schools, folks. I'm telling you, they have become corrupt. Here's a 1777 public school book, first grade. Here's what they taught the kids in first grade in America. Used in public, private schools, it's a first grade textbook. Here's how they learned the alphabet. "In Adam's fall, we sinned all." Back then they made the S like a letter F, okay? "Heaven to find, the Bible mind. Christ crucified, for sinners died. The deluge drowned, the earth around. Elijah hid, the ravens fed. The judgment made, Felix afraid." Public school textbook. Interesting. Here's how the youth, young people, learned their alphabet. "A wise son maketh a glad father. Better is a little with the fear of the Lord than great treasure and trouble therewith. Come unto Christ, all ye that labor and heavy laden. Do not the abominable thing which I hate, saith the Lord." That's a public school textbook, folks. Guess what they teach the kids today? "You're an animal. Share a common heritage with earthworms." Here's a textbook that has over 100 pages devoted to evolution theory. Not one mention of creation or God any place in the book. Not one. What has happened, folks? The United Nations has already declared. They had a World Declaration on Education for All in 1990. Called for the nations of the world to adopt a common education system, complete with implementation timetables and recommended curriculum. In our own nation, Goals 2000, School to Work, and the Elementary and Secondary Education Act, Profiles of Learning, are totally consistent with the One World Government recommendations of the 1990 UN Declaration. You ought to get hold of Bob Fry in Minnesota. We'll put his address up here and you can call Bob about more stuff on the... He's very involved in fighting this type of thing right here. A humanist said in the Humanist magazine, John Dunfree said, "The battle for mankind's future must be waged and won in the public school classroom, by teachers who correctly perceive their roles as proselytizers of a new faith that will replace the rotting corpse of Christianity." This guy said, "Every child who enters school at age 5 is mentally ill because he comes to school with allegiance toward our elected officials, founding fathers, institutions, government, patriotism, nationalism, sovereignty. All these prove the child is sick because the Welsh individual is one who has rejected all those things and is what I call the true international child, communist, of the future." Dr. Pierce from Harvard University. "Well, Dr. Pierce, I'll buy you a one-way ticket also to the Soviet Union if you use it and don't come back. I've been over there, folks. You don't want what they've got." Here's a social science book, public school book. They said, "Any child who believes in God is mentally ill." "Education is the most powerful ally of humanism, and every American public school is a school of humanism. What can the theistic Sunday school, meeting for an hour once a week and teaching only a fraction of the children, do to stem the tide of a 5-day program of humanistic teaching?" They're right, folks, and they're winning. We're losing. One professor said, "As a matter of fact, creationism should be discriminated against. No advocate of such propaganda should be trusted to teach science classes or administer science programs anywhere, under any circumstances. Moreover, if they are now doing so, they should be dismissed. You should fire them if they believe in creation." An Iowa professor said, "You should fail any student, no matter what the grade record indicate, if the professor discovers the student is a creationist. Furthermore, the student's department should have the right of retracting the grades and possibly even degrees if the student becomes a creationist later." That's the kind of thinking we're up against. Mr. Yefremov lives here in Pensacola. He came to my house several years ago. He's from Ukraine. He said, Dr. Hovind, here's my high school diploma. I said, yeah? You know, you're 50 years old, you got five kids, a couple of, you know, four in college. Why are you handing me your high school diploma? He said, when I was in Ukraine, I went to school, I had good grades. They grade them 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, five's the best. He showed me his report card, all fives, like straight A's. He said, but we had a test to take before we could graduate. Senior year in high school, one of the questions on the test was, do you believe in evolution? I answered, no. They refused to let me graduate. I said, well, how'd you get the diploma? He said, oh, you remember last year when we made your videotapes in Russian and he did the voice on them? I said, yeah. He said, I sent them to my village where I grew up in Russia. The mayor watched them, made all the city council watch the tapes. And they said, wow, Eugene went to America and became a movie star. They put him in the public school to make all the public school kids watch him. The kid who was there, the guy who refused to let him get his diploma 35 years ago, had now become a city councilman. And the mayor said, oh, go ahead and send him his diploma. Okay, yes, sir. He said, I just got my diploma in the mail. What do you think, Brother Hovind? He said, wow. What a story. See, the humanists have decided years ago they're going to use the education system to spread their evolution and humanism, because that way we pay for it. We're paying to spread their religion. So what's going on, folks? Communism is anti-Christian in every single way. The communists have 8 rules for revolution, different ways, different things they want to do to take over a country. We don't have time to go over them all now. I have to cover that some other time. Or get our college class, CSE 103, where we cover this in much more detail. Evolution is the foundation philosophy for Nazism. Why did Hitler do what he did? Well, we'll cover that tomorrow night. It's the foundation for Nazism, communism, socialism, Marxism, and the New World Order. Coming soon. We'll talk about that tomorrow night. Very politically incorrect. You don't want to come tomorrow. And then we'll tell you what you can do about it.
Amen.
Coming next.